If it ain't woke, we'd better fix it. Depending on which side you take, that's either a rallying call to make the world a better place or a ridiculous catch cry killing free speech. When it comes to knowing what's offensive and what isn't, you'd think common decency would always prevail. But with the internet being such an effective transmitter of outrage, as well as an instant weapon to publicly shame perceived offenders, it's not always the case. So in this war of words, what can and can't we say? And who should and shouldn't be cancelled? Talk about fanning the flames of outrage. Britain's king of controversy, Piers Morgan, likes nothing more than pulling up a pew outside London's Kensington Palace.
Up until now, I kept my feelings to myself.
Great to see you.
And you, nice to see you.
Scones or skanes?
It's pronounced scones.
These days, Piers has plenty of time to soak up the royal view because the cancel culture mob has claimed his usual seat on British morning TV.
Just wanted to say I really appreciate your honesty on Good Morning Britain.
Oh, thank you.
His treasonous crime, criticising the equally outspoken Harry and Meghan.
Everybody's looking to cancel somebody these days.
It's crazy, so, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're all walking around on eggshells, terrified of offending people, terrified of losing our job over a misspoken tweet or a comment on Facebook. And it's got to stop.
In the non-contact combat sport of cancelling, Piers Morgan is a target impossible to miss. But he's by no means alone.
Posts on TikTok called for Eminem to be cancelled.
ABC has cancelled its hit reboot of Roseanne following Roseanne Barr's racist tweets.
The news is littered with the names and destroyed careers of many who've broken society's new rules and refused to change the way they talk about religion, gender, and race.
Thank you for coming.
Everyone from comedians to academics, actors, and celebrities
will eventually get to straight white men are not allowed to talk
are now being scrutinized like never before.
Concern over content.
Dr. Seuss copped such a tongue lashing from the woke brigade, his estate ditched some of his old books. Pepe Le Pew got slam dunked out of Space Jam 2.
Racial trigger warnings on plenty of their content.
And Disney even slapped dangerous stereotype warnings on many of its old classics.
We are Siamese, if you please.
The origin of woke was well-intentioned. It was to have an awareness, to be awake to racial and social injustice. We can all sign up to that. But it's been hijacked by a bunch of extremely illiberal people professing to be liberals who have now become the modern-day fascists. But these people are marching around like they're Kim Jong-un with a dash of Vladimir Putin. And to me, that will kill our societies.
So, hi.
Hello.
Thanks for joining us.
Along with most of the world, 3 months ago, Piers Morgan was glued to Oprah Winfrey's much-hyped interview with the Duke and Duchess of Sussex.
3 days before our wedding, we got married. Just the two of us in our backyard with the Archbishop of Canterbury. And
as I watched this, I just kept thinking, well, that's not true. That's not true. They couldn't have got married 3 days before they said they did, because that would make the Archbishop of Canterbury a criminal. So there were a lot of things that were coming out of Meghan Markle's mouth in particular, which I knew were untrue.
This is a two-hour trash-a-thon of our royal family.
So he went straight on air and said exactly that.
I'm sorry, I don't believe a word she says, Meghan Markle.
Well, that's a
I wouldn't believe it if she read me a weather report.
And
the almost immediately, the internet lit up, as did the ITV switchboard. First came accusations of racism, then worse.
I didn't know this at the time, but Meghan Markle had personally complained to the boss of my company, ITV, on the Monday night.
Really?
Yeah, I wasn't told this till after I'd left, and I was demanded that I apologize for disbelieving her, or I would have to vacate my chair. I thought there was hypocrisy. I thought there were downright lies coming out in this interview, and I saw my job to hold these two people to the same account I would hold a government minister. And for doing that, you know, within 36 hours, I had to leave the job.
You continue to trash her.
OK, I'm done with this.
No, no, no.
Sorry.
And
no,
leave he did.
Do you know what? That's pathetic.
You can trash him, maybe not my
own. No, 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 no.
Walking out of Good Morning Britain in the middle of their live broadcast.
You're not allowed to have strong opinions about things. You're not allowed to disbelieve a liar like Meghan Markle. I'm sorry to call her that, but she tells lies. And we've demonstrated that and proven that. Well, why can't she disbelieve somebody like that? If you started telling me a lot of whoppers right now, am I supposed to believe you? Do I have to believe you? It's crazy.
There were plenty out there at the time who said that you're just an angry old man.
Well, I just think, you know, it's the old Winston Churchill line, isn't it? If you've got enemies, it means that good, because it means at some stage of your life you stood up for something you believe in. And freedom of speech to me is more important than actually the Meghan Markle debacle or anything else.
I think what's different here is that you have this extreme paranoia on the part of people who used to feel quite comfortable, you know, with their place at the top of the table, leading the country's conversation, and are now feeling a bit threatened by the fact that audiences can talk back.
High-profile activist and journalist Ash Sikar isn't afraid to take Piers on. She says cancelling is not a new form of mob rule, but an important tool of social justice.
I don't think that the problem matches up to the scale of news coverage, conversation, and moral panic that's around it.
Now, come on. Dr. Zeus is gone with the wind?
So I think those things aren't examples of cancellation. What we see are really important literary texts, whether it's children's literature or a piece of cinema that is absolutely iconic, being interpreted and critiqued in different ways. That's not an attack of freedom of speech. That's actually in the spirit of academic interrogation and freedom of speech itself.
It's the topic of freedom of speech, or the lack of it, that makes Piers's blood boil. So much so, he's written a book about how the internet is killing it.
Social media is now the ultimate form of the kind of tribalism we had 2,000 years ago. You sign up to an echo chamber. Most people just follow people they agree with, who reinforce your opinions about everything. So I think we are in a culture war. I'm prepared to fight it as a liberal, appealing to fellow liberals who've just lost their minds. Look, think about what you're doing. Stop telling everybody else how to lead their lives.
So how does someone have a future then, like yourself, in a media landscape that is forever changed, surely?
You stand up for yourself. You stand up for what you believe in, and you protect the basic freedoms of the country you're in. Even in Australia, the woke brigade are snapping at people's heels, trying to put everybody back in their box now. And it started in America, it's come to Britain, it's come to Australia, and it's a real menace.
Ah, that troublesome Dr. Zeus.
Yeah, Noddy, Dr. Zeus, Enid Blyton. They still sell.
This peaceful seaside bookshop in Sydney feels a long way from the raging waters of cancel wars. But if we were in America or parts of Europe right now, a number of these books would be hidden away in shame.
You can't cancel history. History's not ours to cancel. We don't own it. So selling parts of history, to me, I think is perfectly normal. We still sell copies of Mein Kampf when they come in because it's a part of history that is important to how we got here, and banning it and never selling it doesn't advance anyone's anything. We're just pretending that didn't happen and history isn't ours to erase.
Unlike in other countries, owner Julia Wilson believes her customers are smart enough to make up their own minds about what they want to read.
In reality, people are going to lean whichever way they're going to lean. But I think the majority of people have common sense. And I think there's an awful lot of hype about, oh, but the left say this, and oh, but the right say that. But I think, you know, certainly within my world, the majority of people that I know live in that middle section who are just going, wow, you guys are really being quite crazy about this.
Julia has a unique viewpoint on cancel culture. Not only a bookshop owner, she's also a well-known comedian. And as a former bouncer, she knows how to read a fight.
I don't think political correctness has gone too far. You can't say racist, homophobic, misogynistic things anymore. That's a good thing. And if you think you're being hamstrung because you're not allowed to say those things anymore, you need to have a real good look at yourself.
It's here in New York where the book trade is really feeling the heat, with calls for classics like To Kill a Mockingbird and Huckleberry Finn to be banned from schools. But it's not just old books. Many risky new books are struggling to be published too.
I would say that you should publish books, not cancel them, and that the public, that the general public, ought to have the opportunity to judge for themselves whether they think the book has merit or not.
Tony Lyons, the owner of publishing house Sky Horse, says it's madness and is defiantly continuing to print the books the rest are scared to touch.
Most publishers seem to be more focused on what the whole world thinks about what their decisions are rather than why they're making the decisions.
Sky Horse's latest title, Cancel This Book, claims we are in the grip of a free speech crisis.
They wanted to just cancel as many people as they could.
Its author, Dan Kovalik, is glad Tony has his back.
It used to be sex sells. Now it's cancel culture.
Absolutely. And it used to be that progressives would brag about reading banned books, and now they're asking that books be banned.
When he's not stirring up trouble, Dan is a high-profile human rights lawyer and peace activist. Not someone you'd expect to be taking a stand here. But he's doing it because he believes the woke police have gone too far.
What they're going to say about you is this raving left-winger is a right-wing nut.
Yeah, and they're already saying it. No, they're absolutely. I'm out in the cold. But if that's the case, then that's the case. I believe what I believe, and I'm going to fight for what I want to fight for. I mean, my feeling is this sort of attack on individuals, on works of art, on works of literature, is not advancing the cause of social justice. And to bully someone in the name of social justice, I find particularly offensive.
But taking it to a cancel level is so different to what we were used to.
So the U.S., at least, I can speak as an American, has this strange history of kind of mob rule at times. And this is what this is. This is the mob reacting. And in the day, you had to literally go to your barn and get your pitchforks and your torches. Now you can do it from the comfort of your bed with your fuzzy slippers on.
Dan says the mob's targets are often ordinary people making honest mistakes who get wiped out without mercy.
I think that cancel culture depends on silence. If someone's being mobbed, and I've seen this, I've seen friends being mobbed on Facebook, on Twitter, you got to defend your friends. And most people don't want to do that because they're afraid they will be victims of cancel culture. You have to take that risk. Because it's only when people who care remain silent that this can go on. And that's why I wrote this book. I don't want to be one of those people.
What often gets dismissed as being thin-skinned and hypersensitive is actually just people saying, I want to be respected and I want to be treated as equal.
You tried to cancel me, Michael. You tried to cancel me, you tried to keep me off the airwaves.
Academic and activist Ash Sakar has her own spot on digital channel Navara Media. She likes discussing controversial topics and encourages her viewers to chime in live on Twitter.
It's important to have a shared arena in which political contestation can take place.
It's like a kind of woke talkback radio, which she says is empowering for everyone.
Social media has sped up the conversation. Before, you'd have to wait a couple of weeks for your letter to get to the newspaper and for it to be printed in reply to an article, whereas now it's absolutely instantaneous. What this is a reflection of culture changing, with technology and social media changing how we have discussions. The fact that publishing is no longer just about popping your opinion into the atmosphere and getting absolutely nothing back.
But not surprisingly, Piers Morgan, the Daily Mail Australia's editor-at-large, disagrees. He warns that if left unchecked, eventually today's cancellers will themselves end up getting their comeuppance.
Here's what I say to the woke brigade. Right now, what's happening right now will be considered inappropriate in 50 years' time. You'll all get cancelled. You won't have been nearly good enough or virtuous enough for the woke brigade in 50 years' time. That's what they don't realise, is that once you start this process, everything becomes problematic. Everything becomes something that has to be cancelled.
Would you try and cancel a Piers Morgan?
Would I try and cancel a Piers Morgan? Well, I've tried my best and it hasn't worked so far. No, I don't think that cancellation in the way that we're framing it truly exists. Would I criticise Piers Morgan? Absolutely.
Sorry, I don't watch the TV. I just want to know, are you famous?
Yeah.
And it's true. Despite claiming his seat as cancel culture's poster boy,
my mom has a question.
Piers Morgan is still very much enjoying the view from centre stage.
My sergeant would be really impressed.
We're allowed to have strong opinions even if some people wince. That's what made our countries great. And I'm not giving a license to vile racists. They should absolutely be removed from the ether. But come on, everybody, take a chill pill.
Are you going to take one?
I've actually had one recently. I mean, this is the most wound up I've been in weeks.
Hello, I'm Tom Steinford. Thanks for watching 60 Minutes Australia. Subscribe to our channel now for brand new stories and exclusive clips every week. And don't miss out on our extra minutes segments and full episodes of 60 Minutes on 9now.com.au, as well as the 9now app.